19-year-old Marsha Louise McDonnell was a beautiful and dynamic young woman with a passion for art and music. She was also a successful student who had accomplished the advanced level, A-levels, educational requirements necessary for her to gain entry into a university. Marsha had the promise of a good life ahead of her. Then, one cold winter's evening, that promise was savagely taken from her. On February 3, 2003, Marsha and her two friends went to see the movie Catch Me If You Can, and afterward headed toward the bus depot to catch different buses home. Marsha caught the number 111 bus from Kingston and traveled the 10-mile route towards Hampton in southwest London. Shortly before midnight, she got off the bus at Percy Road and walked toward her house located several streets away on Priory Road. However, just yards from her doorstep, she was brutally assaulted. Shortly after 12 a.m., a neighbor was awoken by loud noises and ventured outside to see where they came from, according to BBC News. The woman found Marsha sprawled on the pavement in a pool of blood, slipping into unconsciousness from severe head injuries. She was immediately taken to the hospital for treatment. Marsha's two heartbroken sisters and parents surrounded her as she lay in her hospital bed, fighting for her life. However, there was little chance of her ever recovering from her life-threatening injuries. Her family made the sad decision to turn off the life support machine. On February 5th, Marsha passed away. According to the report, Marsha's grief-stricken parents had to explain to their 5-year-old son Jack what had happened to their big sister. The nightmare was incomprehensible, not only to the little boy, but also to everyone who knew Marsha. What kind of a person would do such a horrible thing? An autopsy later determined that Marsha died from head wounds, possibly inflicted by a hammer or a similar type of blunt instrument. That there was no evidence of sexual intercourse was also established. Approximately a week later, Marsha's sister Natalie, 21, made a public appeal for anyone with information concerning her sister's murder to come forward. Her pleas were met with a surprising response. 1 month earlier, on January 8th, a 17-year-old woman from the Strawberry Hill area of southwest London was on her way back from the local shops, listening to a Walkman when she appeared to have fallen on the ice, according to the BBC. The woman's father found her barely conscious, and she was promptly treated at a nearby hospital. It later emerged that the woman hadn't fallen, but had actually been attacked with a blunt, hammer-like instrument. The assaulted woman had been repeatedly bludgeoned around the head and face, resulting in deep cuts to her scalp, a fractured cheek, a ruptured eye socket, and a concussion. The head trauma was so severe that the woman was unable to remember the event. Authorities believe that the person who attacked her was likely the same person who killed Marsha. Several weeks after Marsha's murder, and less than a mile from where her body was found, there was yet another attack. This time, the victim was an 18-year-old man who claimed that an unidentified hooded man tried to strike him with a heavy tool resembling a hammer or wrench. The 18-year-old escaped unharmed, but was unable to provide police with a detailed description of the assailant. Investigators grew increasingly concerned because there were few leads to work with, despite the increasing frequency of the attacks. However, approximately 1 week later, a witness came forth with critical evidence, which police hoped would help them identify the attacker. The witness helped to construct an effete sketch of a man that was seen leaning over a young woman's battered body late one evening in Walpole Gardens, Strawberry Hill. The victim the witness encountered turned out to be the 17-year-old woman who barely escaped death after being viciously bludgeoned on January 8th. The composite sketch was the first big lead in the investigation. It depicted a man in his mid to late 40s with short dark hair, a prominent nose, and dark eyes framed with bushy eyebrows. The suspect was described as being approximately 5'9", with a heavy build, and was believed to have been wearing a thigh-length barber-style jacket, Nick Hopkins reported in a March article in The Guardian. The composite was publicly released in the hopes that someone would come forward with new information about his identity and whereabouts. In response, the police received hundreds of tips, some of which were useful in the ongoing investigation. None, however, led directly to the assailant. In the meantime, the investigation took an unlikely turn when the only known male victim of the hammer attacker was arrested for wasting police time. The police treated the 18-year-old man's story with skepticism after repeated questioning, likely with inconsistencies concerning the alleged assault. Consequently, the young man's case was no longer linked to the other two attacks, which bore marked similarities to one another. The 18-year-old man was not the only one to be arrested in connection with the hammer attacks. In fact, several men and a 16-year-old boy were also detained and questioned by police. All of the suspects, with the exception of the 16-year-old, were released on bail. There was simply not enough concrete evidence linking any of them to Marsha's murder or the attack on the 17-year-old girl in Strawberry Hill. Although the teenager was never charged with the attacks, police decided to keep him in custody under the Mental Health Act. Despite an exhaustive investigation and search for the serial offender, police were unable to identify any suspect in relation to the cases. They were concerned that if they didn't find the suspect soon, he'd strike again. It didn't take long for their fears to become a reality. On November 5, 2003, accounts clerk Don Brunton, 36, left a bus station and was walking down a footpath to the Hatton Cross Tube Station in Felton, London, when an unknown assailant attacked her from behind with what authorities believed was a sledgehammer. Don suffered severe injuries, including a fractured skull, cheekbone, and eye socket, several stab wounds to the back of her head, and severe bruising in her stomach area, possibly from kicking, the Hounslow Guardian reported in November 2003. Investigators believe that whoever attacked her was likely the same person who murdered Marsha and attacked the 17-year-old girl the previous January. Then, on April 18, 2004, yet another young woman was assaulted. While walking on Trafalgar Road near Twickenham Green in West London after an evening out with friends, Adele Harbinson, 34, was bludgeoned with a hammer-like instrument from behind. Even though she suffered severe injuries, she was lucky enough to survive the horrific experience. Like the previous victims, Adele had little or no memory of the attack or the attacker. Detectives working on the case believe that the offender may have a particular dislike of women with light-colored hair because all the victims had either blonde or light brown hair, the Mirror reported in August 2004. His hate would result in yet another murder on August 20, 2004. After an evening out with a friend at the Crystals Wine Bar, French national Amélie Delagrange, 22, said her goodbyes and left for home. Shortly before 10 p.m., she got on the bus alone and traveled towards Hampton, but accidentally missed her stop. Justin Davenport of the Evening Standard suggested in an article that she continued until the bus terminated at Fulwell Bus Garage before realizing that she had gone too far. Slightly anxious, she asked the bus driver for directions and then began the long walk back home. On her way, she passed through Twickenham Green, where she was attacked and killed. Half an hour later, a passerby found Emily's battered body by the cricket pitch and flagged down police. She was immediately taken to a nearby hospital, but her injuries were beyond treatment. Emily died shortly after midnight from head wounds believed to have been caused by a hammer-like tool or crowbar. Emily's family was devastated by the news. Emily was excited about living and working in England, and she'd been living there for only a few months before her life ended so abruptly. As arrangements were being made for her funeral, investigators clamped down and began a more intensive search for the hammer murderer who was terrorizing the southwest of London. Investigators working on Emily's case quickly realized that her murder was likely committed by the same person who had killed Marsha and committed the other three attacks. Emily's physical description closely resembled the other victims, and all of the attacks occurred at night within a 5-mile radius of one another. Moreover, the weapon used in the attack left marks that were similar to the ones left on the other victims, indicating that the murderer probably used the same or similar instrument in all of the attacks. Although Emily's murder bore marked similarities to the other attacks, there was an important difference. This time, the killer stole some of his victim's personal belongings. Missing from the crime scene were Emily's Sony Ericsson T300 mobile phone, her purse, house keys, and a CD Sony Walkman. Burglary is not expected to have been a motive for the killing. The killer had probably taken the items as trophies. Just days after the murder, there was a significant breakthrough in the case when some of Emily's missing belongings were recovered, including her mustard-colored purse, Walkman, and house keys. The items were found by police divers in the River Thames, close to a bridge near Walton, Surrey, 5 miles from where she was attacked, according to the BBC. The police tracked her mobile phone signal to the location, which enabled them to find the objects. However, although they were able to pick up the phone signal, they could not find the mobile itself. In the meantime, detectives released CCTV photos of Emily in the hopes that they might trigger someone's memory. The images depicted Emily on the bus approximately 20 minutes before she was brutally murdered. Investigators believe that the killer might have spotted Emily after she got off the bus and waited for her between two cricket sight screens in Twickenham Green. Jonathan Brown reported in The Independent that the screens were dismantled and removed by police for forensic examination. Not long after the release of the CCTV footage, reports were released suggesting that minutes before Emily was murdered, A young blonde schoolgirl was stalked as she crossed Twickenham Green after getting off a bus. Justin Davenport of the Evening Standard stated in his article that a short man in his 30s with a side parting followed Emily Dillon, 16, as she tried to catch up with her sister and two friends walking further ahead of her. In the report, Emily was quoted as saying, "It's very scary to think what might have happened. It's likely that she, instead of Emily, would have been the killer's next victim. The fact that she was not completely alone might have deterred the murderer and saved her life." A hammer-yielding maniac attacked yet another blonde woman just days after Amélie was viciously murdered. Sarah Bell reported in the Richmond and Twickenham Times that the 28-year-old victim was hit from behind on the head with a blunt instrument on Hounslow Road in Feltham sometime between 10:15 and 10:45 p.m. on August 23, 2004. Bell further claimed that the woman had no memory of the event, but after regaining consciousness, she went home. 2 days later, she sought treatment at the same hospital for her wounds. Days after, not far from the most recent attack, a suspicious hammer was found at a recreation ground on Bear Road in Hounslow, Andrew Rain reported in the Richmond and Twickenham Times. Forensic experts examined the tool for fingerprints and any other evidence that might link it to the latest victim, Emily's death, or any of the other attacks. Experts didn't know for sure whether the actual instrument used in the attacks was indeed a hammer, but if it was, it would likely be a flat hammer weighing up to 4 pounds. The weapon could also have been a bat, crowbar, pipe, or some other kind of blunt tool. In late August 2004, police were seeking out other leads in connection with Emily's murder, which included a three-bedroom bungalow called St. Moritz, located in Walton-on-Thames. The search was prompted by someone who called in the police tip line with new information. Ben Taylor and Duncan Gardam reported in the Daily Mail that 60 officers spent 3 days searching the bungalow, believing that the suspect might have been hiding out in the unused property by sleeping rough. Forensic experts helped search the property, which had recently been broken into. They looked for fingerprints, dredged the drains, and used dogs to sniff out any evidence possibly related to the murder, the report said. It remains unclear whether anything important was found. In another development, police arrested a 22-year-old man in East London's famous Whitechapel district in connection with Emily's murder. A September 2004 article in The Independent claimed that the man was released on bail pending further inquiries before being detained under the Mental Health Act. In the months following Emily's murder, 4 more men were arrested. 3 were released on bail, and another was detained under the Mental Health Act. None of the suspects had been charged in any of the attacks. After the arrest of the 5th suspect, the police asked the public for assistance in tracing a white Ford Courier with the registration number P610XCN, which was seen circling the Twickenham Green area on the night Emily was killed, the Richmond and Twickenham Times reported in a November 23 article. The van was believed to be a critical link in the case that could lead police to the identity of the murderer. Serial killers like the Hammer murderer don't stop until they're apprehended, so the list of victims was expected to grow. In March 2006, after an intensive police investigation, a man was charged with the murder of French student Amélie Delagrange. Police identified the man as Levi Bellfield, 37, a father of 3 who worked as a bouncer and wheel clamper in West London, the BBC News reported. Bellfield also faced a series of other charges ranging from kidnap to attempted murder. On October 15, 2001, Anna Maria Rennie, 17, was standing at a bus stop in Twickenham when a dark car resembling a Ford Mondeo with 2 men in it raced up behind her. Justin Davenport of the London Evening Standard reported that one of the men grabbed her and tried to drag her into the car, but she managed to escape. Bellfield was implicated in the attempted kidnapping of Rennie, although the second man allegedly involved has not been charged. It's unclear if investigators have identified the man or if he's been retained in police custody. Bellfield was also indicted for the attempted murder and grievous bodily harm of hairdresser Irma Degrassi, 33. Dragoshi was viciously attacked at Longford Village, West London, on the 16th of December 2003, after being struck on the head with a blunt instrument. She eventually recovered from her life-threatening physical injuries, although the psychological scars remain. On the evening of May 28, 2004, Gumley House Covenant School student Kate Sheedy, 18, stepped off a bus in Isleworth and began walking toward her home when her attention was drawn to a suspicious white car resembling a Toyota Previa, with its lights turned off and revving engine. The BBC reported that Sheedy tried to avoid the vehicle with blackened windows by crossing the street because she felt uncomfortable. It was then that the driver in the car turned on the lights and began to drive down Wharton Road before making a U-turn and driving toward her, Sheedy stated in the article. Suddenly, the car ran over her, crushing her torso before reversing and running over her a second time and speeding off. Even though Sheedy suffered severe injuries, including a ruptured liver, collapsed lung, broken ribs and collarbone, she managed to contact her mother on her cell phone, who then contacted emergency services. Sheedy amazingly survived the harrowing experience and was able to provide investigators with important information about the car. The police probing the incident believed that Sheedy's attempted murder was related to the murder of Amélie Delagrange that occurred 3 months later due to the similarities between the victims and location, the BBC reported. Both women had similar hair color and were attacked in the same general area in Twickenham. Investigators managed to obtain CCTV footage of the white vehicle believed to have been involved in the hit and run. The video depicted two people in the car at the time of the incident. One of them is believed to be Bellfield, who has since been charged with the attempted murder of Sheedy. It would not be his last charge. In May 2006, Bellfield was also indicted for the murder of Marsha McDonnell, who was killed by a blow to the head by a blunt instrument in Hampton shortly after stepping off a bus on February 4, 2003. Bellfield was incarcerated at Woodhall Prison prior to standing trial for the series of charges against him. On February 25, 2008, he was found guilty of the murders of Marsha McDonnell and Amélie Delagrange and the attempted murder of Kate Sheedy. The jury was unable to reach verdicts on the attempted murder of Irma de Grouchy and the kidnapping and false imprisonment of Anna Maria Rennie. Bellfield is sentenced to life in prison with the recommendation that he never be released. The conviction and subsequent lifting of reporting restrictions on the case now allow police to reveal that Bellfield has been linked to at least 20 similar attacks upon young women in southwest London, including the murder of Surrey schoolgirl Milly Dowler. In August 2009, Surrey police submitted a dossier to the Crown Prosecution Service, the CPS, containing evidence of Bellfield's involvement in the murder of Dowler. On March 30, 2010, Bellfield was charged with the kidnapping and murder of Dowler, as well as the attempted kidnapping of then 12-year-old Rachel Cowles on the 20th of March 2002. Bellfield did not give evidence at his trial and denied any involvement in Dowler's death. A jury convicted Bellfield of Milly Dowler's murder on the 23rd of June 2011. On March 30, 2010, Bellfield was charged with Dowler's abduction and murder, predating the earliest of the other three charges by almost a year. He was named as the prime suspect in connection with the murder in the immediate aftermath of his first trial in 2008. As a result, the inquest into Dowler's death was adjourned. On the 6th of October 2010, he appeared in court via video link and was formally charged with one count each of attempted abduction, abduction, and murder. Bellfield's second trial began at the Old Bailey on the 10th of May 2011. And on the 23rd of June, the jury found Bellfield guilty. He was again sentenced to life imprisonment the following day, and the trial judge once again imposed a whole life order. The trial of Bellfield on another charge, that of the attempted abduction of an 11-year-old girl who was offered a lift in the Walton area by a man in a red car on the day preceding this murder, was abandoned due to newspapers publishing prejudicial material. On January 27, 2016, Surrey police announced that Bellfield had admitted, for the first time, abducting and murdering Dowler after being interviewed about whether he had an accomplice. Bellfield later issued a denial that he had made any such confession, but Surrey police stood by their earlier statement. Police were informed in early 2015 that Bellfield, in his cell at HM Prison Wakefield, had admitted to unsolved murder cases. The Metropolitan Police coordinated the subsequent investigations of 10 police forces. On the 9th of November 2016, they issued a statement that read, "All lines of inquiry have now been exhausted, and the decision has been taken to close this investigation, as there's no evidence to link the individual to any case for which he has not already been convicted." It was later revealed by police that Bellfield may have lied about other murders so he could inflict pain on their families. Regarding the 1996 murder of Lynn Russell and her daughter Megan, BBC Cymru Wales reported that Bellfield had allegedly confessed to the murders to a fellow prisoner, giving details that would only be known by the killer. In December 2017, the Sunday Times reported that Bellfield's ex-wife, Joanna Collings, had told investigators in the Delagrange case that he had been with her on the day for her 25th birthday, the time of the Russell murders, and had spent all day in Twickenham and Windsor, 100 miles away from the scene of the murders, which occurred at around 4:30 p.m. It was an alibi that detectives found credible. Collins had helped detectives convict Bellfield for his previous murders, such as in the Milly Dowler murder, giving evidence that he knew the area where her body was left well. In regards to the Russell murders, however, she clarified in a BBC documentary in 2017, "My daughter was born in 96, and that was the day of my birthday. He never left my sight, all day and all night, so there's absolutely no way he could have got from Twickenham, where I lived, or Windsor, where I kept my horses, to Kent, done what they say he did, and got back without me knowing he was there. I can, hand on my heart, I hate to say it, but I can say, hand on my heart, he didn't do it." In February 2022, it was claimed by Stone's lawyer, Paul Bacon, that Bellfield had confessed to the murders of Lynn and Megan Russell in a 4-page statement with details he claimed only the killer would know. However, as well as his former wife previously saying it was not possible that he could have been in Kent on that day, a member of Stone's legal team also later admitted that there was nothing in Bellfield's statement which was not already in the public domain, suggesting he could have fabricated it using known evidence. Bellfield was born on the 17th of May, 1968, in Isleworth, London. He had two brothers and two sisters, and he was 10 when his father died from leukemia. He grew up on a council estate in southwest London, with two brothers and two sisters, and he has Romani roots. Levi initially studied at the Forge Lane Junior School and then joined the Rectory Secondary School in Hampton. He later joined the Felton Community College. It's believed that Levi Bellfield has 11 children with 3 girlfriends. He fathered the 3 youngest of his children with Emma Mills, his last girlfriend. According to his girlfriends, Levi was a controlling boyfriend, and he allegedly once forced one of his girlfriends to sit on a stool for a whole night, slapping her every time she tried to get up or ask a question. She was so terrified of him that she soiled herself rather than move or ask permission to go to the toilet. The same girlfriend told investigators she found a knife and a magazine with the faces of blonde ladies in them scratched out. He also reportedly told her that he despised blonde women and that they deserved death. Levi had worked as a nightclub bouncer for a while before opening his own wheel clamping business in West Drayton, West London. The neighbors all knew about his dodgy daytime dealings, spotting him out clamping cars with pals and then bringing them back to the house, and hearing rumors about his dealings with drugs whilst he worked as a nightclub bouncer. Although it's not known exactly where Bellfield worked throughout his career as a bouncer, he is thought to have been a doorman for the nightclub Discotheque Royale in Uxbridge, once the Regal Cinema, better known as Liquid and Envy. Bellfield also bought and sold car parts at a giant car sales site operated by British Car Auctions at Blackbush Airport. He's thought to have changed cars around 20 times per year, and so regularly visited the site, which was a mile away from where Millie's body was found. The judge imposed a whole life order, twice, meaning that Bellfield will serve the sentence without the possibility of parole. To date, Levi Bellfield is the only offender to have received such a sentence on 2 occasions.